Okay, so welcome to Computer Vision course this semester, fall 2020. I hope all of you are in good health. Now, I'm gonna share my screen with you and then we can go over the syllabus. Today will be an introductory lecture. Okay, so let's again go to our slides. I think I can directly go to the PowerPoint, which is good. Let's do the this way. Okay, that's good. All right. So, guys, our course is named Computer Vision, and I'm really guessing that everybody has an idea what we will be talking about this term. Vision, would you argue that vision is the most important sense, one of the most important senses in our life for our survival? Both humans, all kinds of mammalian, and maybe I could say for most of the animals, animal kingdom, vision is the sense that we rely on, right? Think of animals, they track their prey and they catch and they we maybe I could should go to humans. We understand our surroundings, right? Our location, our the objects. We interact with our environment through vision. So I think it's really not arguable to discuss the importance of vision. So what are we trying to do in computer vision? We are trying to make, in a way, actually computers see like ourselves, right? Like human beings. So it's there are some definitions like computer vision is building artificial systems that process, perceive, and reason about visual data. What is visual data? Actually, I would be happy if you do interaction, if you would sometimes just make comments. Can you name some types of visual data? Or maybe, okay, I can just go ahead and say it's like images, of course, through collected through your camera, video, there are medical images, there are laser scanners like LiDAR, laser-based, which capture, for instance, 3D point clouds. That's also in the realm of 3D vision. This course is about 2D vision, by the way. So it's a scientific discipline that studies and that tries to make computers, like I said, efficiently perceive, process, understand the visual data. Okay, so all right. Thank you. You guys are present. Yes, near infrared, MRI. Exactly. Thank you, guys. So this is a slide I'm always putting up in the last 2 years. I've been showing this slide at first, in the beginning. This is from Blue River Technology, a startup, AI startup. They use computer vision and deep learning to differentiate between weeds. Weeds are those plants that are not wanted, unwanted plants in your field. And though there are, of course, plants that the farmer is trying to grow, right? So this Blue River Technology, they were actually a fourth-year computer science students. They formed this startup. They built this system through computer vision and deep learning technology. The input is from cameras that are inserted under this tractor, this section, these sections. And they process those images, like I said, to differentiate between wanted and unwanted types of plants. And then they spray, then the system, of course, sprays some kind of drug to or pesticide to get rid of the unwanted weeds, right? So this was bought by John Deere, the probably largest tractor company, as far as I remember, for about $300,000. So the reason I put this up is, of course, we all know we are in a AI, artificial intelligence revolution. We are facing it, age of AI. And I think startups really take important part in this AI revolution. And once you have an idea that, for instance, those big companies like I'm showing here, they have not dealt with or tackled with, your startup is very likely to be acquired by a larger company. So this is, and the relation to computer vision is, computer vision is one of the, probably the largest area under AI. Because AI, current AI mainly builds on, the deep learning mainly builds on data, right? It's driven by data, and visual data takes the largest space in the in that data cluster, I could say. So computer vision is really everywhere. I know you guys are, I mean, probably taking pictures with your smartphones every day, like Instagram, Facebook, as far as I recall, millions of pictures, 1 or 2 millions, the number I remember from past years is, of pictures are loaded, uploaded to Facebook or Instagram every minute. So similarly, YouTube videos, right? I think it was about 300 hours of video is again uploaded to YouTube every minute. So this is really huge data. It's not possible for a human being to process this amount of data manually or with inefficient algorithms. So computer vision and AI is everywhere currently. Like there are autonomous drones, autonomous cars you see. I don't know if you see my mouse, but, and cameras for surveillance are everywhere. Again, your smartphones, professional photographers, of course. And you can really extend the list. So I think we are all motivated. I put some more examples here. We could have looked at some more pictures, or actually you guys could look at more of these guys. I was gonna show you dance pose, but maybe let's continue and we can take a look later because I don't want to actually now go back and forth. This is from my previous actually undergrad and Master of Science student, Rıza Güler. He has a very nice event to PhD. He did it in France. He has a very nice pose estimation. He fits a 3D template on top of people, moving people. And it's really probably one of the best applications and methods in this field. I'm going to show you after we're done, if you can remind me. And there are other important applications. Like, I mean, this was for human pose estimation. We can generate new video. We can augment people into video for augmented reality. And we can create, generate new kinds of synthetic human action, for instance, or like dancing or moving, playing something and things like that. So the other application field is medical imaging, of course. This is one of the pathology, digital pathology is one of the main application areas where you have to count cells. You have to look at their morphology, shape, and try to differentiate between healthy and unhealthy cells for staging many important diseases. And again, this is not possible, of course, without help of computer vision. More examples I'm going to show again, face recognition, object detection and classification in traffic scenes, for instance. We would like to detect cars, people, motorcycle or bicycle and things like that, or whether the person is wearing a helmet or not. Kinect, probably you guys are playing video games. We can now in our homes capture 3D object models in terms of point clouds. We can convert them to meshes, for instance. Then we can form these models and insert them into, for instance, another scene by, of course, doing a 3D calibration. So, guys, so now where is, like, how can we map these different fields of computer vision, computer graphics? I will also relate it to machine learning field, pattern recognition and machine learning. So I know you are aware of computer graphics field, of course. Maybe some of you will specialize in that field. Here we start with 3D object models in computer graphics. I mean, computer graphics and computer vision are closely related. We start with an object and scene model and some description. For instance, here is a model of this famous movie character, Joy. We could, here we would define the geometry, 3D full geometry, and all other attributes like the hair color, you know, the clothes, etc., like the skin tone, eye color, etc. And then we do a forward projection to from this 3D model to a 2D plane. Okay, that's called image formation, and that's what we use in computer graphics. This tells us, or these are formulas or mathematical equations and algorithms to form images from objects. Okay, so here you see this is the forward direction from object to image. Both image processing and computer vision. First of all, image processing, it's just doing processing images in 2D. Tries to extract features, important features, group images into meaningful regions. And actually, it's again very much overlapping with computer vision. In this course, we do both image processing and computer vision. How about computer vision? In computer vision, like we said, we try to understand the 3D world, right, in a way, the structure of the world around us. So from the 2D image, we try to go back to 3D scene or 3D object, 3D world. So you see, we call computer vision sometimes inverse graphics because it's really coming from back from images to the world. Computer graphics comes from the world models to the images. So there is, so in computer vision, of course, it's closely using and related to image analysis, pattern recognition, machine learning. For instance, given this image, on the top left, this Joyce projected image, 2D image, we with computer vision and also, of course, pattern recognition and machine learning, we may want to infer that Joy has blue hair, wears a yellow dress, has her arms up in a T shape, right, is smiling and is happy. So this is what computer vision is trying to say, and also 3D vision tries to locate the object in the 3D scene. And of course, with pattern recognition and machine learning, we try to make inference, right, also make decisions like what could Joy be thinking and things like that. Post a difficult problem because we lose one dimension going from 3D world to 2D images. I hope this is clear, the relation between vision and graphics. And also we will tie it to AI and the other disciplines, because computer vision is really, I could say, at the center of many, many disciplines. It's a very interdisciplinary field. Of course, we are from more engineering and mathematics and computer science side. We deal with, or we are actually designing image processing techniques and machine learning techniques and algorithms, computer vision algorithms. So it ties to all these three here. But other disciplines, like, for instance, or other areas, NLP, natural language processing, it tries to understand the human language, right? This means of communication. And it also actually can make use of vision, visual data to make, for instance, sense of the context, right? Where are the, for instance, if two people are talking, where are they located? So there are all these multimodal or techniques. Robotics, for instance, is a field which heavily, really heavily, densely uses computer vision. Both in cognitive sciences and neuroscience, they try to understand the brain. So there will be brain imaging data like MR, also imaging people, for instance, for understanding behavior, right, expression, things like that. And of course, we tie to graphics. I've shown you how it ties to graphics, but algorithms, of course, because we try to build computer vision algorithms. So visual processing is because very demanding. It's images, video, really, it's a lot more data than, for instance, what sound, speech, or language uses, because I mean, it's multidimensional, right? So it really requires specific architectures. And of course, in mathematics, here, this chart doesn't have it, but optimization, for instance, information retrieval, and all these disciplines are actually somehow interconnected with vision. And I, because it's my field, but I'm putting vision in the center here. So also heavily now machine learning and deep learning is being used in computer vision. It has become actually a crucial component. I'm going to show the history a little bit next. And machine learning, most of you have taken the course. It's a current core technology of AI, right? And it tries to give the computer systems the ability to learn from data, right? Adapt themselves, update themselves to the data or new conditions. And learning is important. Why is it, I mean, you think learning has been introduced to vision? It has been 10 years that actually learning has become mainstream in vision because we want generalizable systems. So I'm going to give you the history a little bit next. For generalizable, meaning for adapting to a more wide variety of conditions, new conditions, really learning, updating, or the ability of a system to update itself is very important. So we are all in this big field of actually AI, artificial intelligence. I'm putting computer vision as a, you know, occupying a big region here. This is also done by other researchers in the field. Machine learning is, a, of course, subfield of AI. So AI, what is AI trying to do? It's trying to really give the machines the ability to understand, right, reason, in a way, act, plan, or make decisions like humans do, right? So it's trying to give human abilities, thinking, cognitive abilities to machines. So in, vision is actually trying to do the same thing, mainly with visual data. And we know machine learning is a specific subfield of AI. Of course, there are non-learning based AI, deep learning is occupying or getting a lot of attention because it has really made a lot of progress to be put into the field, right, to practice with the machine learning, particularly deep learning. So these are teaching machines to learn the environment. We are trying to hear, teach the machine to see. There are all other fields, subfields or areas under AI, natural language processing, robotics, of course, sound speech processing. There are others that I haven't written here. So in this course, actually, we will be studying all these computer vision methods that don't use learning. You will be like, why? Why? I mean, it's really now all about deep learning. But I really believe you will see that you should know the low-level processing. So I was saying in this course, we will be studying fundamentals of vision, computer vision, and they involve mainly extracting lower, low to mid-level features of images. Actually, I'm going to talk about those so we could really continue actually, if this is clear for everybody. So guys, this is important because this Hubble and Wiesel, they were the first people and actually they received a Nobel Prize for their discovery, for discovering how visual understanding in a way or visual function is mapped in the brain. They did their experiments with cats. They inserted electrodes into the brain and particularly the visual cortex at the back. They showed the cats different objects, like for instance, they showed flower, I mean, clock, I'm just making up things, ball, things like that. Actually, they were not getting much. The signal was not really very meaningful. So you in certain electrode, you are measuring the response, right? And in those years, these monitors, these systems, slide systems, and they showed different pictures. Actually, an interesting thing happened there in their experiment. When, for instance, you show a picture, then you record the brain signals, then you try to shift or go to the next slide, the next picture. And then there is actually a vertical line appears while you are changing the slide, sliding actually the slide. And interestingly, the cat's brain, all those visual cortex neurons responded to seeing those vertical lines. And those scientists, brilliant scientists, really said, wow, it's not really this holistic. The neurons we are studying currently, it's not like they are responding to a holistic object. So the formation of this visual understanding in our brain doesn't start with like, hey, this is a cat, you know, this is a monitor. It starts with really understanding or capturing, recognizing these lines, edges actually, in the scenes. So there are neurons in your brain that are, for instance, sensitive in the visual cortex to differently oriented lines. For instance, some are sensitive to 45 degree, you know, some are sensitive to vertical, all these kinds of actually different orientations. And these are called simple cells. So Hubel and Wiesel discovered that. So they give response to changes in light orientation. And then they also showed there is this hierarchical structuring of neurons in the brain. Complex cells, for instance, they respond to light orientation and movements. So it's like when the scene is static, even if you're showing, for instance, a vertical line, there is no response from some of the neurons, but when it moves, it responds, okay? So some are, for instance, responding to movement with an endpoint like this. So you see low-level processing in the visual cortex starts with sensitivity to edges. And I'm saying, again, this course covers a lot of low-level processing because vision really starts with low-level processing. So they really deserved this biggest prize in the science, Nobel Prize. After these guys, I put this for those of you who may be interested in this, like how the light enters the retina through the lens. I mean, light falls onto your retina and, you know, actually it's here from your eyes. It goes all the way back to the visual cortex, okay? Maybe these are somewhat details, but let's look at the visual cortex to see the hierarchical processing in the brain. So for instance, V1 is the part, the neurons there are responsive to things like this. So you see a neuron in the visual cortex of the cat. These are from Hubel and Wiesel's experiments. You know, a neuron responds to such a pattern, light pattern. You see dark, bright, dark. And this is another neuron, but this time a similar pattern. Actually here, bright, dark, but also oriented. You see, these are V1, meaning in the visual cortex, V1 area neurons. There are V2 area, V3, for instance, responds to colors. There is a motion region, MT, I'm trying to say, okay, here. There are all this hierarchical processing, like, I mean, stages of processing. So some neurons are, you see, respond to lower level stimuli. Some are responding to more and more higher level stimuli, like, for instance, functions. They come together to do higher level functions, like, for instance, object recognition. I'm trying to see IT, yeah, inferior temporal cortex, IT. Here, for instance, there are all this information is passed and then processed so that we start recognizing objects. So this was, I think, big discovery. And the systems we design also mainly work in a hierarchical processing way, stages of hierarchy from low, middle to high level. Okay. So there are other visual circuits in the brain. You guys can take a look. I find these very interesting and stimulating. That's why I wanted to show them to you. For instance, in the motor cortex, guys, there are parts, neuronal groups of neurons that are really tied to your fingers, for instance. If you raise your index finger now, I tell you to raise your index finger. Do you see this red spot here I put? For instance, that's the part in your motor cortex that actually processes or is responsible for processing movement of your index finger. So for instance, if you are a guitar player or a violin player, so it's really all about working your brain. Okay, so here is some history. This Larry Roberts has done the first PhD work at MIT in computer vision in 1963. He actually took toy 3D models and extracted edges. Okay, so there were probably just a few cameras back then. So just working with simple blocks, he was actually able to show one can go from 3D to 2D, extract edges and work with feature points around these edges. And from there, I can go back and format 3D model. But these were, like I said, by simple blocks. Still, this is a nice development in the field. This guy is probably, you guys have heard of this guy. He's known as the father of internet, by the way, Larry Roberts. After this guy, let's see, this was 1963, 66. This guy, Seymour Papert, he was at also MIT working on vision. And he thought, because now Hubel and Wiesel found out that edge processing is important. We know where in the brain edges are processed, and we can extract edges from images and form 3D models. Now we can easily solve the problem of computer vision, autonomous computer vision. And this was given as a summer project. Probably most of you have heard this. This is typically told as a joke in every class, probably in every computer vision class, because it's a computer vision, the whole problem of computer vision assigned as a 3-month summer vision project. Of course, after 50 years, we are still working on computer vision, still trying to discover robust models to understand the 3D world. So then in 70s, David Marr is a big name in vision. He actually worked with, also start with edges, you see, from images, from an input image, one could extract edges. And then actually one can get a relative depth, a depth information. So you see this ball is extracted and its 3D model can be formed and extracted from the image. So this was a development in 70s. Then there were other attempts by using, for instance, generalized cylinders. Here, now the researchers moved to representing more complex objects like human shape, human form, biological forms, they said. And they devised, for instance, like representations in this form. Like after generalized cylinders, you can extract again feature points at the joints and form such representations. Then in 80s, now there are more cameras. Of course, until 80s, there were not enough number of cameras or images image collection was not really widespread. There was not enough processing power, but 80s is actually has shown some promise or development. Now there are more cameras. So people really started to work on real images this time, realistic images like this one. There are razors. For instance, there are 9 or 10 razors in this picture. How can we really extract this information? How can I write a computer algorithm to tell me there are 10 razors in this picture? So in 80s, people came up with nice edge detectors like Kenny edge detector. John Kenny, 86. He has a very robust edge detector. By the way, edge detection started much before Sobel, Irwin Sobel in 68. He was one of the first people to come up with an idea, filtering idea to extract edges. We will see his edges. Then edge algorithm. Then actually, once you have these good edges, robustly extracted, nicely extracted edges, you can have a template edge model of a razor, for instance, and try to do matching. So this David Love did that. So now bring a template here and try to match the edges of that template to the edges of the objects in this image. Then in 90s, we have segmentation. We will study all of these. Actually, we will study, for instance, grouping, which is segmentation. Now, people said, can we move beyond edge detection? Can we do group pixels into meaningful regions, parts? For instance, a human. Of course, ideally, it should be like a human figure, the green area, the sky. And you can see that actually the mountains, the sky, the place where the person is sitting. Here, similarly, it's the umbrellas, right? They form a group. Or here, it's this building tower, which forms a group. So this was the years of segmentation techniques, actually. Then in 2000, it was all about matching, extracting features and doing recognition with matching. There is a very famous algorithm called SIFT, again by David Law. His algorithm extracts key points from images, important points, and then forms feature vectors that describe each of these points. For instance, it could be a histogram of gradients around each point. And the idea was that these feature points are distinctive, and the feature vectors that we extract are invariant to some transformations, like, for instance, rotation, a different angle, like different viewpoint transformations, different lighting conditions. And when you use histogram of gradients, actually, you achieve most of these. So then, actually, once you extract, for instance, the features from this image for a stop sign, you see this picture on the right is very different, and you can still, in an invariant way, robust way, if you can capture these key points and this, extract their feature vectors, you can do a matching, feature matching between these two to recognize that on this path there is a, or in this picture, there is a stop sign. Okay. And then 2000s, there is face detection. This is also a huge development in the vision field. These guys, because are the first to bring machine learning actually into computer vision. So in a way, now computer vision community is about to meet machine learning. So after, I think one of the reasons this work was important was that in a few years after Viola Jones proposed this face detector. These, you see, the algorithm to put faces in boxes. This technique was translated into the industry.